Hello everybody, welcome back to my channel where skincare is all about progression over perfection because perfection doesn't exist. I didn't really know what to call today's video, I was a bit like, but today I'm going to talk about four mistakes that I feel like we all make in our skincare routine or related to our skincare routine or things that have kind of compromised our skincare routine, stopping our skincare from being the best it can be. See, I couldn't think of a title. This isn't dirt, by the way, it's the design on the t-shirt and I realize it just kind of looks dirty, so ignore that. I want to get the really obvious one out the way first of all, not using sunscreen. Now, I don't want to be one of those influencers that's like, you must wear sunscreen every day. Make sure you reapply. Don't speak to me unless you reapply sunscreen, all that kind of stuff. And this isn't about aging and this isn't about tanning. This isn't about skin cancer, which are all, of course, important factors for you to consider when it comes to why you should wear sunscreen every single day. And there are other factors that not reapplying sunscreen throughout the day or wearing it all together can have on your skin. And I'm going to speak from a personal perspective here. The first one being darkening of dark spots. Because of the sheer amount of actives that we have available, AHAs, tranexamic acid, kojic acid, you know, all these amazing active ingredients that help target dark spots and hyperpigmentation. Probably one of the main things that is going to stop your dark spots and hyperpigmentation is wearing sunscreen and protecting your skin against those UV rays. So if you are using all those amazing actives, vitamin C, AHA, tranexamic acid, in order to even out or reduce hyperpigmentation, but then you're not wearing sunscreen or you're spending a lot of time out in the sun and then not reapplying, even if you apply it in the morning, that's good, but you need to reapply. There's no point doing any of that because it's just gonna ruin it. It's a waste of time, it's a waste of your product. Redness and rosacea. As somebody who has a lot of rosacea, I have very easily sensitized skin, very reactive skin. If I do not wear sunscreen on a sunny day in general, no matter what time of year it is, my rosacea flares up within seconds of being outside. And I do so much for my redness and for my rosacea, and I'm sure a lot of you do as well. Azelaic acid, tea tree sometimes. Urea is a new one that I've really been enjoying. Really expensive LED treatments. And that it takes months and months and months to see any difference. And I have done it in the past and can ruin that all by just not reapplying my sunscreen once I get outside. There have been times that maybe a dog walk has gone for a little bit too long. I forget to bring a sunscreen stick with me and it's just redness and I have to start from scratch. It takes minutes, seconds to ruin what months of skincare has done for my redness and rosacea. So this segment now is sponsored by Isntree. We all know they do some of the best sunscreens, most viral and most popular sunscreens. I feel like I don't need to introduce you to these, but it's the Hyaluronic Acid Watery Sun Gel, an SPF 50 plus PA, 4 pluses, broad spectrum, and the same here, but this is the Hyaluronic Acid Airy Sun Stick. So I apply SPF first thing in the morning. I'm just in the habit of doing it now, often in place of a moisturizer. We all know to find yourself a lightweight, non-sticky, non-greasy, non-irritating, non-eye stingy sunscreen like this one, but also one that gives you that kind of like hydrating and moisturizing feeling. We have 8 types of hyaluronic acid in here for like real good hydration, centella asiatica as well to help soothe the skin, which I love for my easy sensitized and rosacea prone skin. Then these sun sticks are perfect for reapplication throughout the day. So always start your day with this, reapply when you can with this, but if you're out and about and you want to reapply your sunscreen super easily, then the sun stick is the way to go. So this has niacinamide and adenosine in, so it's not only going to protect you from the sun, but also all those other skincare goals that you're trying to achieve. Again, super hydrating, and it has this teardrop shape on the top of it, which I've mentioned before is great for getting into like all those awkward crevices that we tend to avoid or miss because they're hard to get into. Be generous with this when you're outside, quite a few passes of this for a reapplication, which is why you need one that is super lightweight, non-greasy. So the more you reapply it throughout the day, it shouldn't be getting greasier and greasier, which is why I love this one. The next mistake I feel like we do all the time when a new trending ingredient comes around is obsess over that ingredient. And I'm gonna use vitamin C as an example. With every new launch and every new trending ingredient, every new TikTok that comes out from an expert talking about a key ingredient or something that they use on their patients and all this kind of stuff, we always feel like we should be using a particular ingredient or trying this next ingredient because it's going to be the one that works for us. Remember, like, deeply trying to love vitamin C. Again, I'm going to use as an example. For, in particular, it's a great antioxidant, but for evening out skin tone, reducing post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation for where I would pick spots, I remember really, really trying to love it and thinking this is going to work for me. Like, don't get me wrong, there are some vitamin C serums I absolutely love. Peach and Lily do an amazing one, which is a great direct treatment for post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. Fades it beautifully. Summer Fridays, Glow Recipe, Naturium, all do vitamin C serums that don't feel like a really horrible old-fashioned vitamin C serum, just a hydrating serum, right? But for me, I just couldn't integrate it into my routine, knowing that I was trying to use it for a particular reason and it wasn't working for that particular concern. For me, ingredients like niacinamide, alpha-arbutin, kojic acid again, have always worked better for me than any other trending ingredient or ingredient that experts say we should use for this particular thing. But vitamin C, for example, again, has always been put on this pedestal that is the go-to ingredient for hyperpigmentation. And I just think to myself, why didn't I just use what I know works for me? And I feel like it's because it's within me to want to use and try and experiment with something that could be potentially better. And I feel like I was always trying to find that potentially better vitamin C serum, and I just never found it, and I don't think I'll ever find it. And I feel like trending ingredients is a thing anyway. We all know that. I feel like we all know what's good for our skin, what works and what doesn't. I think hyaluronic acid is a really good example of a trending ingredient that's always been in our skincare, always been in our skincare. It was probably one of the most effective ingredients in an anti-aging Olay moisturizer, for example, over like the collagen that they used to publicize as the anti-aging ingredient. And I can't remember when, but hyaluronic acid was just labeled on everything. Everything it was in, it was like, contains hyaluronic acid. On that note, just use what works for you. I know it's kind of like coming from me. It's exciting to try and use new stuff and new ingredients, but don't try and make something happen if it's not happening. Or don't stop using it because someone on TikTok says there's something wrong with it, or a skincare expert says there's something wrong with it. If it works for you, keep using it. I feel like snail mucin has like this hate train against it now. The COSRX snail mucin was trending and popular for about 3 years. Now, all of a sudden, because a few people have broken out because of it, people are like, I'm not using it anymore. Put that snail mucin down. If snail mucin works for you, keep using it, you know? Don't miss out on stuff just because it doesn't work for somebody else. Here's a tip for a very particular product, a very particular ingredient. Hyaluronic acid doesn't need wet skin to work. Also, don't worry about the climate around you. You can still use hyaluronic acid. Nothing's going to suck moisture out of your face. I was shocked when I learned this. I personally did like to apply hyaluronic acid onto damp skin anyway, mainly because hyaluronic acid serums tend to be quite thick. You know, if it's got more than like one type of hyaluronic acid and it's quite thick. So putting it onto wet skin, it just helps it glide over the skin. And also I feel like a wet skincare routine makes your skin look dewy and plump and fresh. Of course, I learned this from Michelle from Lab Muffin Beauty Science. I will link, pinned comment will be the video that explains this. But to cut a very long story short and probably make it a lot more scientifically inaccurate than Michelle actually explained, hyaluronic acid is more like sticky tape, not a magnet. So hyaluronic acid isn't drawing in or sucking in moisture from anywhere. So if you put it on your skin, it's not sucking out moisture from your skin. If you put it on your skin, it's not sucking moisture out of the air and it's not pulling moisture out. And because it's not a magnet, it's more like sticky tape, it only works when it comes into contact with water or from a very short distance, I believe. So you don't have to worry about sucking out all your moisture. She also mentions that serums and moisturizers, we should really know this by looking at ingredients lists, are pretty much mostly made up of water anyway. So there is in fact enough water content in our ingredients for hyaluronic acid to be plumping enough. Hyaluronic acid is a great humectant that can really help your skin if you wanna, you know, puff out your skin in a good way, fine lines, make it look dewy. I've had my ups and downs of hyaluronic acid and I'm more of a glycerin user myself, but you know, use it. Your skin's not gonna become dehydrated. It doesn't matter if you live in a humid climate or whatever is, you're going to be absolutely fine. One thing I've noticed a lot in my comments section and on TikTok comments actually is a lot of people still believe that there is such a thing as filler ingredients, and this affects whether or not somebody will use a product. And I feel like you are missing out on a lot of really, really good products if you are presuming water, for example, is a filler ingredient, and I'll explain why. There is no such thing as a filler ingredient. Brands are not bulking out your skincare to try and sell you more, to try and make it look thicker, or to get more money from you. It costs the lab, the brand money to use each and every ingredient. So if they do want to cut down on ingredients, they will do that. If they feel like they can make a good product without all those extra ingredients that they feel is needed, they will do that. It wouldn't just cost you money, it will cost them money to produce. But the main one I see is that I'm not using that. It's like 80% water. You need water in your skincare, especially I believe if you're using actives. Most ingredients that we look for in our skincare that make the difference to our skin are water soluble. They need water in there to be able to, you know, mold and formulate into the ingredient, into the product. So it's not like people in a lab are just getting like a big bucket of water and chucking in a bit of powder and a bit of, you know, whatever and being like, oh, then they're never gonna know. It's just bulking ingredients and water. That's not how it works. And whilst I do think water-free products are interesting from an environmental impact perspective, you know, as far as like making them travel friendly, they're not heavy because they just come in like powder form. I think that's interesting. And some of my favorite cleansers, for example, are powders that you add water to. And that being said, a lot of our favorite products are already waterless anyway. You probably haven't even noticed, like The Ordinary, the vast majority of their serums are waterless and they do amazing actives and formulations. But don't go purely looking for waterless skincare because you think it's a thing, unless it's for the eco-friendly perspective, because I honestly feel like you're gonna miss out on a lot. And I feel like you have nothing to gain and your skin has nothing to gain purely from a waterless skincare routine. But yeah, there are a few things I've noticed. I haven't done a video like this for a while because I feel like a lot of us are clued up on skincare. But as new information comes out, I feel like a lot of misinformation comes out as well. And I also learn a ton of stuff too. Of course, check out Lab Muffin's channel. I will link it in the description below. And that particular video has a pinned comment. And thank you so much to Isntree for sponsoring the beginning segment of today's video. Check out the you probably already own these, to be honest with you. I feel like everybody who has a skincare collection owns these two products. But yeah, amazing. You know that already. Thank you so much for watching today's video. You can check out some more product reviews here, some general light entertainment here, and I'll see you over there.